Hi, I'm John Riley. I'm here at the Memphis Drum Shop, and the proprietor, Mr. Jim Pettit, asked me to talk a little bit about the four drum books that I've written. And the first one is entitled The Art of Bop Drumming, and then the second book is Beyond Bop Drumming. And those two I kind of see as a continuation of a story. The third one, The Jazz Drummer's Workshop, was an outgrowth of a bunch of columns I wrote for Modern Drummer magazine, and I tried to assemble them into a logical, sort of pedagogical approach. And each chapter in that book can kind of be looked at as a lesson for a week or however long it takes to master that lesson. The fourth book is called The Master Drummer, and it's based on a DVD I made, I think, in 2009. And it's kind of a prequel and a much more advanced step in relation to the other books. In terms of prequel, I talk about hand technique and show some things that Joe Morello taught me, which are much better to see. And that book has a video links to it through the Hudson website. So I'd like to begin by playing the first comping example in The Art of Bop Drumming. And even before the first complete example, you know, the first comping idea, the first complementing or accompanying idea that drummers played was known as the kick beat. And it went like this. And that snare drum note, that accent on the three end of every other measure, was a signal to dancers that that's where they should kick and turn. That's one of the first comping rhythms I learned. The second one is the Charleston rhythm, and I think everybody's familiar with that. So the very first comping example in The Art of Bop Drumming combines those two licks, those two comping ideas, and it sounds like this. Some people are not really understanding why drummers play the things they play. But I will try and convince you that this is not random stuff that's going on. There's a musical basis for it, and there's the idea of sort of unifying, uplifting the band, and playing in a conversational way. And so the phrases that I've included in these books, for the most part, are geared toward that. And in The Art of Bop Drumming, it's dealing primarily with drumming styles from the 1940s and 1950s. In Beyond Bop Drumming, it's dealing with the innovations of Roy Haynes, Elvin Jones, Tony Williams, where the comping got more elaborate, became more three-voice oriented, and can be pretty challenging. As we get into the master drummer, as I said, there's some prequel kind of stuff about hand technique, and then there's a section on soloing, which involves the literal phrases of my heroes. And it presents different treatments on how to master them and then how to personalize them. And I think that's everybody's objective, is to learn the language, but to have your own point of view about how you use this stuff. It's not that you need to invent a language. There is a language there. And you want to get control of that so that you can morph it to fit the context that you play in. So we started with this very simple comping idea, which I could also play. Doesn't sound bad. It sounds like it lifts up the feeling of the time. Then we want to get more and more command of the instrument. And as I said, each of these books progresses and becomes more challenging. One of the phrases that I really like from the master drummer is a phrase that's a combination of four notes and three notes. And when you put them together, you get a phrase that's seven notes long. And it goes across the bar line, it creates some tension. And the challenge is to play that idea without distorting it, to play the cymbal and hi-hat without altering them, and to be able to keep track of where you are in a four measure or eight measure phrase. So it would sound something like this, maybe a little faster. I think looking for things that challenge your coordination and your concentration is really beneficial to gain more control of the instrument, to gain more freedom when you're on the bandstand. And I think what our objective is to study what the masters played, but have our own point of view about it. And we take phrases that we've heard from other people and then we begin to distort them and assemble them together in a way that's pleasing to us and that connects with the people we're playing with. And I think all four of these books will help you achieve that with more clarity, with greater variety in your playing, and I'm sure they'll stimulate a lot of different kinds of thought. So I hope you'll give them a look. Thank you.